the Philosopher Honor Society here on campus. We're doing a running series of talks, and I hope you'll join us for the proceedings after the break. Again, this is from, this is all because of the Student Government Association, the SGA. They gave us a nice sum of grant money if you're able to do these. So, our speaker today is the director of the Honors College in Seattle University. He's a very accomplished scholar in hermeneutics and interpretation, and was a close contemporary of Gadamer himself. So there will be a question and answer period directly after this. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. James Risser.
Okay, I'm going to talk about the question of truth in art from the perspective of Gadamer's hermeneutics. I divide my remarks into, I'll say three parts. Could be four, I forgot already. The first one is just to pose the problem of truth in art. When Gadamer develops his hermeneutic theory in relation to the problem of knowing in the humanities, which he does in his major work, Truth and Method, he begins with a large discussion of that question of truth in art. He claims that it is indeed possible for there to be truth in art, and considers the experience of art actually to be exemplary for this whole understanding within the humanities. So certainly the humanities cannot provide truth in the way that normal science does through methodological procedures and the strict criteria for verification. What Gadamer actually claims is that in the experience with art, as an experience of understanding, a truth can be communicated that cannot be verified by the methodological means proper to science, or for that matter, for any methodological means. So that's where you get the title of his book, Truth and Method. So to see how this is so, about there can be an experience of art, let me begin with the very question about truth and art. So just in general. From our commonplace way of talking about art, as well as from aesthetic theory within philosophy, we do not attribute truth in art. Why? Because we regard art as simply an imitation of some reality outside the artwork. Or worse, as simply an expression, let's say, of a creative subject. So regarding imitation, one could say at best that any truth in art has the character of being truth to, rather than a truth about. You know, a still life painting, and you say, oh, it looks just like the bowl of fruit on the table. Or a character in a novel, maybe you say, well, that's truly like someone I know in real life. But then it's the real life, and the art is simply a copy. In each case, we look for a correspondence outside the artwork and deem the artwork to be an imitation of the real. So, insofar as that artwork is not the actual reality, begin to think of Plato here, we conclude that art is not concerned with knowing, and the experience with art is directed back to the subject who views the artwork in terms of enjoyment, or pleasure, or satisfaction. How many times do we stand in front of a painting and say, I like that? We go to the theater production, well, I really enjoyed that. So we stand normally, our commonplace conception is we stand before a work of art, whether it be a painting, a poem, a theatrical performance, and judge whether we like it or not on the basis of aesthetic qualities alone. Now, a quick note within philosophy. The aesthetic theory that would have us consider art along these lines, Gadamer places under the rubric, a subjectification of aesthetics. and he attributes to Kant a decisive turn in that direction. It's Kant of the Third Critique. If you're philosophy students, you know Kant writes three critiques. We barely can read the first one. We rarely ever get to the third one, which is about art, called the Critique of Judgment. So with Kant, the determination of the nature of aesthetics rests on the subject in its feeling of pleasure, because, Kant argues, aesthetic being can't meet the criteria for rational knowledge that he sets out in that first critique. So the extended consequence of this aesthetic theory is to regard art in terms of what Gadamer calls aesthetic differentiation. That's where the aesthetic quality of the work of art is separated, that's a differentiation, from its content and its relation to the world. Aesthetic differentiation is going to isolate the work from everything in which the work is rooted, the context of life, its religious or secular function, which gave it significance, turning the work into a pure work of art. I'll repeat this example of Michelangelo's painting of the Sistine Chapel. If you look at it just aesthetically, you see nothing about a religious world being presented, a history of humankind being presented. You just say, oh, that's a beautiful painting. But you see, that's the aesthetic idea, notion, aesthetic differentiation. And the museum does this in its own way by promoting the false impression that a work of art is a mere picture. You know, just go look at the next picture, and it's lost its contact with at least the Michelangelo Sistine Chapel. It's in the Sistine Chapel. But we take artworks in museums and they lose all context to a relationality to a culture in the world in which it was composed. Now, here comes Gadamer. Against this, Gadamer claims that the, I'm quoting him now, the pantheon of art is not a timeless present that presents itself to a pure aesthetic consciousness, but an act of spirit, difficult word to understand here in English, that has collected and gathered itself historically. End quote. So it sounds like he's almost, if you aren't familiar with Hegel, he's talking about how there's something, when he says spirit, you could almost, it's the German word Geist, it also means mind. So at least, you know, there's something there. It's just not form and content and colors or and whatever. That art is about an act of intelligence. So, but his point needs exemplification. Do we really think that the Greek tragedies were performed, that the Sistine Chapel ceiling was painted, that Mahler's Song of the Earth was composed only to give the viewer pleasure? That's how you can put the question dramatically. When we approach the artwork as part of the broad sweep of historical life, it is more than something to be enjoyed. It presents us with something to understand. And that's Gadamer's claim. And once it's something to understand, then you can raise the question of truth. So, as such, the hermeneutic experience of art amounts to a mode of knowledge and stands in some relation to truth. And to keep this claim in perspective, let me say that for Gadamer, art is a form of truth. It may be the case that truth is not simply truth, it could be forms of truth. And the task here is to see what form it takes. Now, Gadamer is going to try to show that there's truth in art by, because I never think of Gadamer as such a radical thinker, but what he's going to do is he's basically going to deconstruct or a kind of a dismantling of the typical concepts that, at least in philosophy, we use to talk about art. And that means that art, he doesn't consider art as an object. He doesn't even consider art as a work. He's going to dismantle the whole idea of imitation, the Greek word mimesis. So I'm going to lay out Gadamer's theory, and you can see at every turn, if Gadamer's confusing to you, it's only because he's ripping away, he's trying to rip away the typical concepts you use to think about what art is. So, Gadamer thinks we misconstrue, to start, Gadamer thinks we misconstrue what a work of art is as a work, what it's really supposed to be. He doesn't think it's an object that we can grasp by some process of measurement. You know, like maybe the approach of art history, when you want to regard the work in science, some kind of scientific way of measuring it. He doesn't think the artwork is a product that is simply finished when the artist's work is done, you know, making an expression of the creator. He says, the artwork is simply itself. It's a kind of ordering in relation to a sensuous appearing. That's the most general way of talking about it. I avoid talking about an object, I avoid talking about it as some genius's creation. It's the presentation of order. It's the order of a, or all art is sensuous, a sensuous appearing. Now that's a very general description. Let me start being more specific. Let's grant from the outset that an artwork is the presentation of an image, even for the poetic work. In several places, Gadamer asserts that for language in general, a word is not simply a sign pointing to something outside of itself. You know, like in semiotics, here's the word ball, and that, or here's the word pen, and it refers to this object out here. He says it's more like an image that forms in relation to the world that appears in language. And what holds true for the word also holds for the image as such. Now, when he starts talking about image, it's no longer the way that we have this understanding of image ever since Plato, namely that every image is a copy of something. Rather, he understands it simply, there's a play on the German word here for copy, it's Nachbild, for an, he could talk about an image as a semblance, as an Abbild. I'm sorry for using the German word, but Gadamer's clearest here, because he wants to say, he wants to talk about image simply as Bild. Now that's the German word, if you're familiar with, you know, like the German version of our Time magazine is called Bild. So the German word Bild simply means picture. Or image. So, Gadamer thinks the artwork is the presentation of an image. But you have to hold off the minute you start thinking of image, exactly what he means. So, for Gadamer, an image does not have, is not always a case that it's a semblance of an original or a copy of original. He says, notice when you have a copy, how it's really defined. A copy is always going to point itself, point beyond itself to what it copies. In other words, it kind of dissolves itself. When you have a copy, it's only because it's a copy of something. So it has no reality really on its own. It gets its reality from the original. He says, the image that is the artwork, though, is not intended to be canceled out like the copy is to be canceled out because it's only a copy of an original. And so for him, the image of the artwork is something of a world that has come into being. It's presenting itself rather than representing something outside of it. This is going to be his main point, to get to overturn that whole idea of imitation of something. The artwork stands for itself. It's not copying it. Yeah, maybe a copy, so you can have representational art. But as you know, not all art is representational. So the artwork is trying to present something. And that's, I'm going to keep trying to elaborate that point. Do we really think, for example, that Arthur Miller's play, shows you how old I am, one of my references. Do we really think that Arthur Miller's play, Death of a Salesman, the main character, Willie Loman, only copies the reality of a modern, alienated salesman? Or for that matter, that Kandinsky's abstract painting, Black Spot, 1912, is merely a symbolic of the spiritual. or that the performance of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony is merely a rendition of its composition. You see, in my questions, I was trying to get us, we were always trying to go beyond the artwork and not let it just look at the artwork as an artwork. So, Gadamer describes this way in which an artwork is a self-presenting appearance. It's self-presentation. He's going to talk about the artwork as a self-presenting appearance, as a transformation into structure. So here's a complex philosophical notion. I'm going to give you the German expression because I have to translate the German words for you. In German, it's Verwandlung ins Gebilde. So at least you can hear that word Gebilde even in here. So a transformation into structure. Now let me explain. The word structure does translate this word Gebilde, but at the same time it covers over what the German word is trying to say, which has its root in Bilde. So what's a Gebilde? It's really, when I said structure, it's really a formed image, an actuality that has become figured. In the ordinary use, Gebilde can refer to patterns of textiles or the structure of a building. But Gebilde, for Gadamer here, is something that's actively formed, that the artwork develops into its own pattern from within. And it's going to be grasped as its own, as a kind of a further formation of something that has appeared. Okay. The word transformation needs explanation as well. Transformation is more than a change within continuity. That's not what transformation means. Transformation signals a break such that there is a new identity. So what previously existed no longer exists. This is going to be a transformation. Something is suddenly wholly something else. Transformation. So in the entire phrase then, the transformation, he's saying an artwork is a transformation in structure. What is he saying? So there's something being actualized, has become completed. And when actualized, what is actualized becomes a new actuality. Now, that may sound, depending on how far back your background in philosophy is, you think about it, I'm being very Aristotelian at this point, and that is Gadamer. It's this language of potentiality and actuality, and I'm going to say it later on. But the word for actuality in Greek is energeia. And it doesn't mean just actuality, it means activity. And so when we move that into the Latin, we actually sometimes, and it becomes actualitas, we're almost mistranslating Aristotle. We have to keep thinking of Aristotle, almost the biological. It's all about movement and the reality coming into itself. Okay, and Gadamer is going to actually try to use that conceptual language to try to think of the artwork. So for Gadamer, this transformation is a new formation, an actuality that's raised above any comparison with the outside world. It's a wholly transformed world. And one sees something maybe for the first time. That's its transformation. And that's why he says this transformation is a transformation into the true. Now Gadamer gives an example. So you say, what are you talking about with this actualizing into a new formation? He gives, I'm not sure how good his example is, but he says a child plays, he dresses up to pretend to be, let's say, a parent or someone else. The child intends that what he or she represents should exist, just as the actor in the play. So you say, hey, Johnny, you playing your dad? No, I'm not Johnny, I'm my dad. I mean, it's that kind of a movement where you're actualizing something, it comes into a formation. And what's real is that formation, not the thing that preceded it. So the artwork is going to have its own authority for that audience to discover. So the artwork is not a reproduction of the world, but it's enlarging. And Gadamer calls this enlargement an increase in being, by which he means there's something more than is already familiar. So we can think of this more as a kind of a heightening effect, that sometimes when people say art is more real than life, so that art can really present something that you didn't see before. So from everything that's been said so far, you see that Gadamer wants to give the artwork its own autonomy. He doesn't want to say, it's something made by the artist or something like that. And it's not simply copying some outside reality. It has its own autonomy. So that means it's going to have its own measure, and it measures itself by nothing outside of it. Think immediately of a poem. A poem works best when you try to find the meaning of a poem. Where do you look for the meaning? Within the words, within the poems. You let the one word resonate with the other words that are used in that play of language. You don't quickly say, well, that word there, he's using the word excessive. Oh, yes, I was with my buddy down at the bar last night. He drank excessively. I know what excessively means. No, you don't do that. You let the words play in their own meaning within the poem. So, in the drama, maybe the drama critic wants to look out, takes its measure from outside of it. The drama critic may say, Dustin Hoffman played a good Willie Loman. But you, the spectator, and trying to understand it, you're not making that gesture. You might make that gesture. But if you're really hearing the play, looking at the play, you're trying to see Willie Loman, not Dustin Hoffman. And that's this sense of this autonomy. So, getting back to poetry, he says poetic language is very, he says it's language in an eminent sense, because the words are to stand for themselves in their own autonomy. They don't pass over into what is said as we do in an ordinary conversation. A poetic text doesn't disappear in our act of understanding, but it stands there, confronting our understanding with its own claims. So the poetic texts, he says, are authentically there, a very unusual expression, when the words come back to themselves. In other words, you're not saying, I want to tell you how I'm going to get to Dulles Airport tomorrow, and then I'm there. My words just disappeared because I'm telling you about Dulles. The poetic words continually come back to themselves. So, what's he trying to say? At least in poetry, the words speak for itself. And its norm, the normative function, how you're going to judge what it's saying, originates from itself. The meaning comes from the text, which prescribes all repetitions and acts of speaking. So that's this character of the autonomy. It even works for music. Music makes this autonomy even clearer. Music is not simply an art of sounds, but an arrangement of sounds through timbre, tone, and rhythm, whereby the sounds become figured. It's an actuality of the music is where? There, in the figuration. It resides in it and nowhere else. That's where the music is, in that figuration. So the artwork then does not then carry a meaning that is outside its sensory presentation. It's not outside, it's there. The meaning is there in the work, coming forth in its sensuous abundance. I'll give you a quote from an article he wrote well into his 90s. He says that whether in making music or in listening along as it is played, it is all there. He uses this there quite a bit. It comes from, if you read any Heidegger, it comes from Heidegger's Dasein. It's there. The repetition, variation, the inversion, revolution. But only if we go along with it does it come forward and one receives it. So you see, once I have an autonomy, and ultimately interpreting is going to be related to how we're trying to give the authority to that autonomy. So that brings me to my next point, which is about actually interpreting a work of art. So that's what a work of art is. It has its own autonomy. He described it in terms of this transformation in the structure. So, what characterizes interpreting the artwork under these conditions? It seems that it's still going to follow the character of mimesis. I'm going to use that Greek word. You all understand it. It means it's translated as imitation. So Gadamer is going to say, of course, the artwork is indeed a mimesis. That's the Greek word. But he wants to do justice to the experience of art, he says we should look at the original concept of mimesis. He says, in its original sense, and Gadamer was a philologist before he became a philosopher, he says, mimesis, I'm quoting, mimesis is derived from the star dance of the heavens. See what he's referring to Pythagoras here. Think Pythagoras, the harmony of the spheres. The stars are the presentation of a pure mathematical proportion that constitute the heavenly order. So if Pythagoras is using mimesis here, it has nothing to do with copying anything. What is it? It's not a representation, it's going to be a presentation. So the difference between those two words is key, between representation and presentation. So, in its original conception, mimesis reveals the miracle of order that we call the cosmos. And what Gadamer is going to do is say, you know what? The artwork is in this order is something like the cosmos in miniature. And that's what we're really trying to see. So, art too is a mimesis. It's going to represent something. But what it represents, well, let's talk about that. We're talking about non-objective art. Does that represent something like representational art, the bowl of fruit in a still life painting? Here's Gadamer. It is irrelevant whether or not a painter or a sculptor works to produce objective or non-objective art. The only relevant thing is whether we encounter a spiritual energy of order in the work. I'm still quoting. Art is present whenever a work succeeds in elevating what it is or what it presents to a new configuration, a new cosmos of its own in miniature, a new order of unity and tension. End quote. So you can see how by using this broader notion of art as a presentation of order, then we don't have to deal with some of the very important questions of trying to talk about the difference between representational art, non-representational art, abstract art, and so on. And that idea that an order of unity and tension, you know, that's a philosopher's way, but it's a good way of even talking about music. The order of music is that of a configured whole of all the elements, which are themselves tempered, and is that whole of a complexly differentiated matter that's presenting itself to understand. So, the artwork for Gadamer is a pledge of order. Now, I want to get more specifically to the issue of how we interpret. So if there is still a notion of mimesis at work in the artwork for Gadamer, he says, with that, there is a corresponding form of knowing. And so he says, in Truth and Method, the cognitive import of mimesis is recognition. So interpreting is a form of knowing that's going to be in the form of his truth, is going to relate to this key way he's using the word recognition. So, recognition is not knowing something again that we already know. It is not knowing something for the second time, at least how he's going to use it here. But it's knowing more than is already familiar. As he explains it, the general sense of recognition requires in an obvious way a prior seeing. But what is brought into view is not the prior seeing. I quote, Recognition means that I now cognize something as something that has already been seen. So it's the idea of the as there. What's happening when you say, ah, that's what it is? So what do you see when you recognize the person in a painted portrait, for example? Is it not something more than when you ordinarily viewing the person? So the enigma of this kind of knowing is in this little word as, which is tantamount to interpretation. For it is here that Gadamer says the very wonder, the German word, and it's easy to see it in English, Wunder, the wonder of knowing is hidden. To ask why such seeing should be a matter of wonder, Gadamer does not say, but we can gather a lot. When you recognition, you can't simply do a technique of a step-by-step and say, okay, that's what that thing really is. It's, at least we know this. Part of the process of recognition, that we see things in terms of what is permanent and essential in them, unencumbered by the contingent circumstances in which we may see them in any other time. But this is not arrived at as a conclusion to an argument. That's maybe the wonder. You can't get a recognition by argument. It is an interpretation that may very well have something to do with the imagination. To see something as something. Notice how the as carries out an interpretation. Let me interrupt. Let me show you that. I want to make sure I'm clear today. Here's the pen. This is what I get from when I teach Heidegger. Here's a pen as a writing instrument. Now suppose I had coffee and I mixed some cream in it, and I stuck this instrument in it and I stirred it. It's not a pen as a writing instrument, it's a pen as a swizzle stick. It's such a simple gesture, but it's about the profundity of the as, that kind of a articulation that basically interprets. It's this as that. Recognition is, this thing as that. Okay. When we carry out this as, this formative, what is it? It's a formative bringing into view. And he's going to describe this now, this bringing into view, this more defined idea of interpretation. So, to describe this process is not to suggest that the whole, as I've been doing just now, is not to suggest that the process of understanding art is intuitive or completely mysterious. Gadamer has this preponderance for using the idea of dialogue to talk about how we understand. And he applies it here to art as well. The interpretive understanding of art is going to involve, in this attempt at recognition, something like a dialogue. Now, of course, in an artwork, there's no real dialogical part. But you ever have that experience where the text speaks to you, read that poem, and you say, oh, as if the poem addressed you, was telling you something as you, as a reader? Heidegger uses this language first, die Sprache spricht. Stupid, I didn't have to quote the German, but because it's preposterous in English, language speaks. We always think it's the person who speaks, but why can't we say language has something to say? It's almost a tautology, because language is always trying to make something manifest. Okay, let me stay on task here. So, obviously in artwork there's no real dialogical partner, but insofar as an artwork does have something to say, we encounter it in the manner of a dialogue. In reading literature and poetry, we do this by responding to what the language of the text is trying to say. And this self-presentation of the word is not easy to grasp, especially in poetry. But poetry, he tells us, has to be listened to with the inner ear, where words have meaning in their sonority. and only in the inner ear are the semantic reference and tonal construct entirely one. So you see, he's talking about not just as you hear my words speaking now, when you're reading poetry. Actually, Gadamer also likes to point out originally poetry was never written, it was always oral. When you hear it, you're hearing the meaning as it speaks. So Gadamer describes this kind of a dialogue that we carry out when we read and when we're looking, a hermeneutic gesture towards understanding, as a tarrying or lingering. And one more German word, verweilen, because that gives you this other English word that no one uses. You have to look it up in the dictionary. Wiling. Actually, we do. You say, I wiled away my, what'd you do, Saturday? I wiled away my time. No, we don't say that often, do we?
A poet might,
yes. But you see that this word that's strange to our English ears, what Gadamer means, that tarrying has little to do with relaxation and leisure over something, but it's of that experience of taking time. You know, the difference between going on a highway when you want to get the point from point A to B is instrumental. You go up in the Shenandoah Mountains and you're walking on a mountain path, you're trying to be there on the country path. That's tarrying. Now, but Gadamer is going to give it a little nuance here. He says, tarrying is this experience of taking time, which is not an experience of losing time. It's the time that one can lose is the time that needs to be filled and measurable, and it's also the time that can be boring. Right? In contrast to this, the time that he's talking about, the tarrying, is a filled time, and that's the kind of time that does not last long, nor does it pass away. He says it has its own temporal structure. Let me cut to the quick. It's when you get absorbed in something and you say to yourself, oh my God, where did time go? Well, it's not like time wasn't happening, but what is that? It's where time is filled. And he thinks this kind of absorption is the idea of tarrying, that is the interpretive dimension with a work of art, that you become completely there with it. Again, I refer to music. Has the same mode of a hermeneutic encounter, even though the very idea of trying to dialogue is further removed. Where Gadamer writes about music, he says, the understanding music takes place in terms of taking hold of the temporality of the performance. Such taking hold is similar to the movement of understanding that takes place in the other arts, insofar as the taking hold is constructed as a going along with the whole that is being presented in the art. You ever try to listen to art and just listen to one note? It doesn't work. You're all of a sudden you're not listening anymore. And what you're listening to is the whole. But you're understanding it almost from the middle by which it is already reaching out towards an anticipated end. But you're there with it by trying to see it as a whole, even though you never really see the whole, actual whole all at once. So, for Gadamer, interpreting a work of art involves something like a dialogue where the emphasis is on not confrontation, dialogue like this, but an engagement where you're letting the matter come forth, which takes a certain disposition. So finally, the question of truth in art. What we have seen so far is that Gadamer claims for the artwork an autonomy in relation to which it is to be understood. The dynamics of interpretive understanding follows the principle of dialogical encounter just generally. So, but I didn't say this earlier here, but last night, just as in the dialogical partner can have the superiority, so too in the artwork, it is a matter of being able to see or hear what the work of art wants to say, even when it's a painting. What's it saying? And just as in the movement of conversation, the usual way of looking for truth, verifying correspondence loses its force. So, if I want to talk about truth, you got to get rid of this idea of correspondence, verification, factuality. Well, it is about reality, though. All right, let me proceed. What is at stake in hermeneutic understanding is the ability to disclose the truthfulness that is there in the work, a truthfulness that Gadamer describes as self-validating. If we go back to the example of poetry, we can get close to being able to see how this truthfulness comes about. Notice how meaning in language can be self-validating in certain forms of poetry. Say the pure poetry of Marla May, for example. The reader cannot simply look for a communicative content as if the poetry wanted to tell the reader about the flowers of spring or a stormy night. So, pick a kind of poem like that, and I could actually should refer to Paul Celan, who Gadamer wrote extensively about, kind of a hermetic poetry that defies looking for kind of correspondences outside of it. What doesn't work in this kind of poetry is the customary directions of meaning found in grammatical and syntactical speech. The form of the poem is constructed by the constantly shifting balance between sound and sense of the words. The poem consists of meanings that arise out of the words. The words become self-validating, and the poem's truthfulness resides in what he calls that wonder of language. Poetic language seems to have the power from itself to generate meaning. They all think, well, no, the author wrote the words, right? Well, hold up. Now, getting to the end. Within this miracle that is language, Gadamer captures the self-validating truth with this expression. I have to give you the German. So ist es. Three simple words. What do you translate? So it is. Literally, you almost see that in English. It's like saying, that's it. That's right. That's the way it is. So it is. That's it. So this, you think, God, all this work in philosophy and Gadamer comes down to this. So it is. There it is. But that's what he says. He says, if this experience of truth involves the wonder or miracle of language, that is because the determination of exactly how it comes forth and validates itself cannot itself be put into words. In his essay, This Artwork in Word and Image, Gadamer explains this experience with truth by linking it, as I started, with this concept of Greek concept of energeia, actuality. With this concept, Gadamer claimed Aristotle was able to think a motion that was without path or goal, something like life itself. Where's life going towards? Life. Bearing this sense in mind, the expression, so it is, that's right, which is to capture the truth of the poetic word, signals an accomplishing actuality. There it is. It's become action. There it is. In poetic truth, something comes forth, speaking from the poetic word itself and allowing for a further speaking. But what comes forth comes from itself. There it is. And not from the standpoint of the reader that tries to determine it. And Gadamer thinks this experience extends to all arts. The viewer of the painting looks for the right distance from it. The viewer of the sculptor must look around it. And the viewer of the architectural work must walk around it and gain the right vantage point. So, in other words, I'm not going to determine it. The work is coming from, the it is coming from the work itself. I'm not determining it. Try it. Ever look at a pointless painting? If you get too close, all you see is dots. You're not going to see the painting. So how do you see? It's the painting's going to tell you when you can see it. And you just have to move to where the painting shows what it is. So, where does the right distance come from? From the point where it best comes forth. And in coming forth, The form of truth is that of an unconcealment. Aha, there it is, something has shown itself. Art has its being in this enactment, this movement to completion. Okay, last paragraph. Because of this intimate link that Gadamer establishes between language and the experience of our world, poetry seems to have a special place among the arts for him. At the end of his essay on the contribution of poetry in the search for truth, Gadamer remarks that the truth of poetry consists in, it's a lovely phrase, creating a hold upon nearness. What he means by this has something to do with our existential condition. As beings who are subject to time, all things threaten to escape our grasp. All the events of our lives become entangled in the deeper dimension of forgetting and distancing that characterizes the human experience of life. Against this, Gadamer thinks that the poetic word, and I think for all art, in a certain way, has the ability to counteract that existential reality. Language, he says, always furnishes the fundamental articulations that guide our understanding of the world, such that through the poetic word, the world is brought closer to us. End quote. And so for Gadamer, this hold upon nearness, which can be experienced in an understanding of the poem, or any work really, amounts to a growing familiarity with the world. This is not a romantic theory for Gadamer, but simply the recognition that language gives us our access to the world, and through the poetic word, we're able to bear witness to our own being. Thank you. Gadamer writes specifically about poetry, I'd include any art. And you see why, again, he's saying that. If we go back to this idea that he's critiquing, that art is merely pleasure, I mean, you say, why do we bother, if art is a copy, why do we even bother with it? You know, I mean, it's like, I'll just have the real thing. I don't need a copy of something. And if it's just to give pleasure, you say, well, a lot of things give me pleasure. I can have an itch and I scratch it and that gives me pleasure. So it seems that art should have greater significance. And then when you ask, well, what is that greater significance? He's saying, just as I ended there with his existential condition, well, you're looking at artwork because it has to tell you something, because if it has, you're understanding it means it has something to say to you. But more importantly, it has a significant place in human experiencing. Just for where you took up your question. Because in a way, all of a sudden, you know, the world vanishes in the everydayness of our lives. There's a forgetting is part and parcel of human life. It's not just a psychological thing of forgetting. The world, this is Heidegger, covers itself over quite naturally. And there's art, and it all of a sudden brings me into the world by heightening that experience. And that's what he means by this growing familiarity with the world. A kind of a recovery from forgetfulness.
I have two questions in those. Start with the question about the autonomy of the work of art. So opening it up, we talked a little bit about how Kant, with Kant, we get the kind of the work of art detached from its cultural and historical roots. And even now, you said in the museum, right, we kind of go to the museum and look picture by picture by picture, and that's detached. And so it seems that that would suggest the kind of what time is like for the work. And I'm wondering, I may have misheard or missed this part, how does Gadamer explain what those roots, if there are those roots to those, you know, the work of art does have those roots, and is that involved in this experience of interpreting or experiencing, how does the work refer back to those things, if it is this autonomous work? Does it at all refer back to those things?
Its autonomy is that it stands on its own. It doesn't mean it's completely isolated from the culture in which it was, let's say, originally rooted.
Mm-hmm.
So, just to repeat, the autonomy is this being able to stand on its own, not like a hermeneutics of suspicion. I see it, and then you look behind it to see what the real meaning is.
Mm-hmm.
And in standing for its own, it's in relation to an experience of understanding, and that's the whole point about Kant. If I could comment on that, interesting, the museum, Heidegger has a great line in The Origin of Work of Art where he talks about, we think of artworks like potatoes in the cellar, you know, it's just things. And what happened with Kant, who, it's a very fine line that Gadamer is walking here with Kant, because Gadamer explains it in his book, is he talks about rehabilitating the humanist tradition. And all of these notions like tact, common sense, and taste were a form of knowing in the humanist tradition, and they slowly lost their force. So now everyone has their own taste, for example. But how did they lose their force? Because they got translated into art. If you look at Kant's Third Critique, you can see just not the idea of taste, but you see the idea of common sense, you see all that, those norms that were forms of knowing in the humanist tradition really get taken over into the aesthetic. And with Kant, though, there is a fine line, because Kant, and even Gadamer says, he doesn't completely subjectify art. So art is a symbol of the moral good, and he also talks about aesthetic ideas in art. So, but Kant simply doesn't give it that autonomy that Gadamer wants to give it, which means that I'm directing it not towards the aesthetic as a categorization by which it automatically identifies something and restricts what it can say. So it stands on its own, and that means I'm going to let it speak and not simply regard it in terms of whether it gives me satisfaction.
So my second question has to do with, how would Gadamer reply to the question of how are we to read a poem, in the sense that, what is it, let me see if I can phrase this, are we misguided when we read a poem? And we say, so there it is, and then we go that other step further and then try to paraphrase or verbalize or
express
the so there it is. If should we just read the poem over again in the way that exhibits our understanding? I mean, that question?
Yeah, no, that's a really great question, because there's so much there to unpack, and I'm not going to do justice to it. So the question of how to read it, I mean, you see what Gadamer was emphasizing, and I only said a little bit. He says you got to go along with it. But what that means is then the this whole idea of the sonority of the, I love that word when you talk about poems, because it's not trying to talk about poems in a decorative way, like they're simply flowery speech or something like that. Now, when he does say you understand something, the interpretation drops away. So I think part of what's behind part of your question is, I see something, it spoke to me. Now can I say again what it has to say? And what's that second gesture that's going on? That's really interesting and complicated, because the way that Gadamer loved poetry, if I could speak for him, I'm not sure what I would have to say personally, but I'd almost say that I'm bastardizing the poem then when I translate it that way, only because, as he says, poetry is always language in this eminent sense, and it seems to have in almost its melodic character, even when, like music, that can be dissonant. The poems are not always just that kind of tonal melody. But even when the poem is not like, even when the poem, well, when the poem has this kind of tonal structure and everything, when you then put it into ordinary language, you do something different about it. So I think it becomes a reinterpretation. And then we're back into the general dynamic of language, where I'd say you're like we do when we're trying to understand something in general, which is you start searching for words and you start going into language to find a word that almost mirrors what you were seeing in the poetic word. And then there's all kinds of questions rather than answers that could follow somewhat like that. Is that a reproduction? Do you lose meaning? Do you lose a sense of the meaning when you do that? How is it, you know, how is that working out? Yeah, I don't know exactly. I see the question.
When we're parsing through these issues, how are we to distinguish between art that is meant to have a purpose and art that's just done? Like, for example, an art student or a fashion student is instructed to do a particular kind of painting or a particular kind of work, and maybe they really just are imitating something that they see with a certain technical interpretation that they're trying to project, but there's obviously a difference between that and Salvador Dali, who has a distinct perspective. And so how do we distinguish those?
Yeah, I don't think Gadamer answers that either. But you see what's in your question. It's really the question of criteria. So that you can say this would be art and this actually wouldn't be art. And so the looseness of the criteria, I would say something like it doesn't speak to the person at all. I mean, it doesn't have anything to say. So really, really cheap imitative art, whatever that would be, let's say, it doesn't speak to the person. So I'm creating a criteria for art versus non-art or art versus bad art by its ability to say something. And you could say, well, you know, how can I determine that? Well, that's the encounter with it. That's the enactment situation. I can't refine the criteria any more than that. But it's almost like when he does it, it's almost like when he talks about when you try to force an interpretation on a text, and all of a sudden your interpretation, all of a sudden the text just isn't saying anything anymore, because you're just trying to control everything in the text. And it doesn't have anything to say because it's already been said, so to speak. So the art should at least, qualifier. The richness of art is that it would, that it can have something to say.
I have a question that kind of, I guess, joins that very discussion, because I made you out to be saying that for Gadamer, it's not just that art should have something to say, but it's got to have something of a certain sort to say that has to do with somehow revealing what's essential or fundamental in things as the object of this act of recognition, so that you get this claim that
the artwork is a pledge of order, I think was the way it was put.
Yeah.
And so to come to my question, I guess, does that then disqualify something like, I don't know, the Wasteland or William S. Burroughs or some kind of what we would take to be an important artistic work or innovation, but one that seems dedicated to puncturing certain ideas about the orderliness of the world and having some kind of basic message of some sort of irreparable fragmentariness or something along those lines? And can Gadamer accommodate examples like that? Because I worry that he's open to some kind of late Heideggerian complaint that he's really just trying to make art do metaphysics in the bad sense.
Yeah. No, I think the
poor art is metaphysics.
I think the issue is just understanding what Gadamer means by order in its context. It's not to be a conservatism of anything about an ordered world and everything, and this is the way it worked in the past, and don't upset the apple cart. I think what he means by a order is this unity in multiplicity, the sense of order that you see in things. So that's the Gebilde thing, almost has a sense of an order of design. So a pledge of order is to just to try to break away from the semblance idea and the orders. Music works best to see this. You have to see this as a pledge of order, but it's not about any specific tradition. It's not about any specific idea. It's about how the mind grasps order. That's what rationality does. And Gadamer's, and I've never said this right before, but he's trying to say that art is kind of an experience of that kind of rationality, that he used the right word, an experience of intelligibility. So it's not just a sense, and it's a curious kind of intelligibility. It's of a sensuous medium and appearance. So it's really it's a generic notion of order that brings together something that can become intelligible. Even if that intelligibility, what it says in that intelligibility is that the world is fragmentary. So that itself could be under a pledge of order, because that's an idea of intelligibility.
Yeah,
I actually think, and this may be too inside of a conversation, I've actually argued that, and I go against Berlusconi on this, it's in all of this, I think Gadamer's actually the more radical thinker than Heidegger. I think Heidegger has much more conservatism than Gadamer. I don't know that you can tell that Gadamer loves art by this very description of what he's trying to say about art. And that's why there's so much to say at the end, but time is short and everything. But you see how he connects. He really, this is the humanist tradition of God. I think Gadamer is one of the contemporary philosophers that is kind of revitalizing the humanist tradition within philosophy, what we call the humanities. And he's trying to show, that art is in relation to our humanity, and not just as a leisure in the ordinary sense where we can go out and enjoy art after we're done working or something. So he really is interesting to look at as a way of seeing ourselves.
All right, let's thank Dr. Risser.